something to bless them this morning. Come on, all over the building, rise to your feet as we go before God in our praise and our worship. Anybody know he's a great God? Oh, he's a great, great God. Oh, God, we bless you. Come on, do me a favor. Everybody just clap your hands like this. Everybody clap your hands. I need to see you clap them. Come on, everybody put them together. Father, we come to give you glory. Glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
To the Lamb who was slain for my being.
To the Lamb who was slain for our being.
Glory, glory, glory to our King. So this is what we do. We cry
glory to our King.
Everybody lift it up and say, we cry
glory to our King.
Oh, glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory to our King.
To the Lamb who was slain for my glory, glory, glory to our King.
Glory, glory, glory.
Come on, lift it up.
To
the Lamb who was slain for my being.
To the Lamb who was slain for our
King. We cry
you're worthy.
High. we cry. God, we love you. Oh, God, we bless you. Oh. And with the fruit of our lips, we begin to bless them in this atmosphere. Not with the clapping of the hands, but with the fruit of your lips. Begin to open your mouth and bless God in this house this morning. Oh, let them hear you. Let them hear you. There's a lifting in the sanctuary this morning. There's a lifting of the hands. There's a lifting of the heart. There's a lifting of the eyes. Beyond the hills to where our help comes from. Yeah. Come on, you should know it. Lift your voice. Say there's a lifting.
There's a lifting of the hands.
All over this house, lift your hands. There is a lifting of.
There's a lifting of the heart.
God, we lift our hearts to you this morning. There's a lifting of. That's all you gotta say.
Yeah.
There is a lifting, yeah.
There's a lifting of the hands.
There is a lifting of.
There's a lifting of the heart.
There's a lifting of.
There's a lifting of the eyes.
Beyond the hills. Stay right there. Let's stay right there. Let's go right there. There's a lifting up.
There's a lifting of the hand. There's a lifting of the heart.
We lift it up to you. There is.
There's a lifting of the heart.
Oh, beyond.
Beyond the hills.
Where I am. Sanctuary, lift up your hands. We will lift up, yes, we will. Begin.
recognize and worship him and thank him for all of his goodness, his kindness, and his mercy. Amen. Little high in this mic. Amen. Come on. Do you love Jesus? Do you love Jesus? Oh, praise God. So glad to be back in the house of prayer, and certainly all of you look okay after Thanksgiving. Amen. Y'all didn't overdo it, and so you look pretty good. Amen. But thank God for leftovers. Amen. Amen. My wife is laughing because I ain't seen no pot on the stove this morning. So we're going to eat leftovers too. We're here standing and wanting to welcome all of you, and particularly those of you that are guests, amen, VIPs, for the very first time. We want to celebrate and love on you. And we have a team of people we call our hospitality team. They are ready, set, go with a gift from the Redeeming Grace Church family to you. And the only way we're going to know that is if you would do us a favor and just stand on your feet. We won't ask you to say anything. We just want to recognize you and love on you. So if you're a guest for the very first or second time, would you do us a favor? Just stand on your feet. Amen. So that our team will come. Amen. Bless you. Bless you, sir. Amen. Welcome. Welcome. God bless you. We got. Amen. Bless your heart.
Amen.
Amen. Bless your heart. Amen. Let's go welcome each other and welcome our guests with the spirit of love and holiness. All right?
Peter answered and said,
you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Congregation.
And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it.
But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Congregation.
For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in the flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity.
And he came and preached peace to you who were afar off, and to those who were near. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Congregation.
Now therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone.
In whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. And all together, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Amen.
Good morning, Redeeming Grace.
Good morning.
All right, y'all want to make some noise in the house. Make some noise in the house. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. These are your Sunday morning announcements. RG pendants are on sale today while supplies last. Amen. Like, share, and follow our new Facebook page at Our Grace CSA. That's at Our Grace CSA. If you would like to attend the Mantles Conference 2018 on November 30th through December 1st, please register at www.mantlesconference.com. That's www.mantlesconference.com. Amen. We've got new rehearsal times, and the choir said, yeah. Okay. Then we'll say it that way. Amen. Amen. Every Wednesday, the youth choir will rehearse at 6 p.m. and the RGC choir will rehearse at 8 p.m. Amen. Amen. That means that's time for what? Refresh Wednesdays. All right, y'all. All right. We'll see you here for Refresh Wednesday at 7 p.m. here in the auditorium. Amen. All are welcome. That means all. That means ain't nobody left out. Amen. All are welcome to come and lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. And get some gas for the rest of the week. Amen. 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 That's some spiritual gas, not gas for your car. Just wanted to make sure y'all was paying attention. Amen. The RGCCSA app can be found in the App Store and Play Store. To give, please go to our app or our website. You can also write a check or bring cash and put it in the envelope. Amen. 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 Redeeming Grace Markets are every second Saturday at 11 a.m. Vendors are needed. So if you're a business owner, you want the community to learn more about your business, please get your 10 by 10 space for $35. Amen. For more information, you can contact Deborah Bez at yahoo.com. That's Deborah Bez at yahoo.com. The multimedia team is looking for volunteers to operate the Proclaim system or stage lights and video camera. You can volunteer. If you can volunteer for just one Sunday or even one service, please, please raise your hand. Please see Deaconess Twyla Varnado for more information. Amen? Amen? We're asking that you follow us on all of our social media accounts and invite friends to check us out, as well as news on our upcoming events and holiday alerts. You can visit rgccsa.org for our calendar or a list of available department and volunteer opportunities. Amen? Thank you so much. The best blessings in life are people like you. So for all you do and for all you are, thank you, Deacon Clarence and Deaconess Marion Thomas. Amen? Amen. Amen. It takes a special kind of person to care enough to take the time for others to do whatever it takes to help somebody out. To Bishop and First Lady and my Redeeming Grace family, for everything you have done, for everything you have given, thank you, Sister Karen Harris. Let's keep her lifted up in our prayers. Amen. 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 Now we're back in the hands of our bishop. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, what a God we serve. Amen. Amen. Today is a very special day for me and Honey. Amen. Amen. I'm not going to do anything silly because she will get on me and I won't eat this afternoon. Amen. But for 2 days, I was trying to make our anniversary happen. So I said, I think Friday night, Honey, happy anniversary. It was after 12 o'clock. She said, it's not the 25th. Said it the next day, Honey, happy anniversary. Ain't today either. So finally, I got a kiss and got it right today. Amen. 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 Now, you brothers know that's about to cost me dearly. Amen. Amen. But I had it 2 days early.
Amen.
I think I ought to be all right, Brother Sullivan. Amen. 2 days early. Amen. Refresh Wednesday. I certainly want to invite all of you, and I tell you why. This is a time that we can get together and get refreshed in the middle of the week.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We've got great preaching. We stay here 1 hour, period. 1 hour, because the choir's got to rehearse right after we finish. We have someone that's going to preach, Pastor Remsen, Shishman. Remsen, amen.
He's
going to be preaching.
Amen.
I always get his name messed up. You're going to be preaching for us Wednesday night. We are inviting all of you, and I promise you, we will not keep you beyond an hour. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So come on out. And I want to thank all of you for how you have responded to what we've asked you to do in terms of tithes and offerings. Amen. I pray that you keep it up. It's about to be December, and we really, you know, like buying gifts, and they got all kinds of, you know, Friday sales and Saturday sales. I understand all that. Amen. I know that you have to provide for your family. But then Jesus' birthday is this month in December. Amen. And I think it would be just kind and right to keep on blessing him through his church. Amen. And this is good ground.
Amen.
Amen.
You ought to know what you're sowing into.
Amen.
This is good ground.
Amen,
amen, amen. We didn't spend 20 years and didn't get a doorknob.
Amen.
So we put the money that God has given us to good use in the form of this building, and we're about to sell the other building, but my mama used to say, don't count your chickens till they hatch. So until it comes through, amen, we are still pressing on, and we need your help. And in addition, those of you that have pledged to give the $25 over and above your tithes and offering, we greatly appreciate that. That helps us with our budget for the month of December and onward. Amen. So great. Thank you so much. Praise God for you. And you ought to give God praise for what he has enabled you to do. Amen. Amen. I'm not going to prolong the time. Amen. I'm going to ask that the best deacons on the planet come, and deaconess, amen, and the best attendants on the planet, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Welcome them as they come.
Good afternoon, church. Please stand. Please stand. We with your tithes and offerings in your right hand, because we give God what is right and not his left. Please repeat after me. This is my money.
This is my money.
My money represents my time.
My money represents my time.
My time is my life.
My time is my life.
And I give my life to you, Lord.
And I give my life to you, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. And now we recite this together, the tithes and offerings confessions. Father, I know that you have a plan for the believer called tithes and offerings.
At this moment, I set my heart to tap into your financial plan of tithes and offerings for me. Satan will not rob me anymore in my finances. In the name of Jesus, by faith, I am at this moment planting my financial seed into the kingdom of God's field. I am doing this because I know that it is a biblical truth, and I set my heart to obey the word. Father, I also know that it is a biblical truth that in return for my financial faithfulness, you are supplying all my needs and above my needs, because I have tapped into your financial plan of tithes and offerings. I believe that you are raising up somebody, somewhere, to use their power, their ability, and their influence to help me. In Jesus' name, I hold fast to my confession in your financial plan of tithes and offerings. Amen.
Got a blessing.
God got a blessing.
God got a blessing.
God got a blessing.
You know God's got a blessing with your name on it. Everybody, I need to see you put your hand together. Oh, come on. You got to act like you're excited about the blessing God got with your name on it. Everybody put your hand together in here. Oh, oh.
Good news. Praise God and thank Him for our choir and our musicians. Come on, let's do that. Let's bless the Lord for them. Amen. They serve us every Sunday. Amen. If you have your Bibles, then you can turn with us to John, the 6th chapter and the beginning with the 5th through the 14th verse. If not, it'll be on the screen. Amen. John, the 6th chapter, beginning at the 5th verse, very familiar passage of Scripture. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish, but what are they among so many?" Then Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. Say, as much as they wanted.
As much as they wanted.
So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost." Therefore, they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets, help me, Holy Ghost, with fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, "This is truly the prophet who is to come into the world." You may be seated in the presence of Almighty God. Thank you for standing. All may be seated. We'd like to use these words as our subject: the plan for bits and pieces. The plan for bits and pieces. Well, growing up in Tennessee, one thing that my mother would not tolerate, and that was wasting food. She would say things like, "Boy, you better eat all that meat off those bones." Now, for me, some of the stuff on a chicken bone was not meat. But if I wanted to leave the table, without pain or other discomforts, I learned very quickly how to clean a bone to my mother's satisfaction. Perhaps that lesson should be taught today, because then we would not have to go to the grocery store quite as often. Are you listening to me? Well, that takes us further. My brothers and sisters, we are bound by natural seasons. We know that certain things accompany winter, spring, summer, and fall. We understand how to dress to meet the needs of these seasons. We certainly would not wear a wool coat during July in Texas with the temperature reaching upwards of 100 degrees. If I saw somebody in a coat, it'd be time to take them to the doctor or something. And at the same time, we have learned to deal with the high temperatures here in San Antonio, but it is a different story for our East Coast friends when the temperature rises to that height. In reverse, when temperatures go into the low teens here, it is a problem for us because no one sells clothes for that kind of Chicago winter. Now, if we get snow that covers the ground or roads, our city closes down because we don't have snow removal equipment or even salt. Well, if that is the case for the natural seasons, what about our spiritual seasons? Are y'all with me so far? There are spiritual seasons that we have to deal with, such as the uncertainties of our times. No one goes into any season fully ready to meet all the challenges that are before them. We all have a tendency to stumble, particularly at the beginning, but because of our relationship with Christ and the confidence that we have in Him, He brings us through, only to arrive at the next season with its uncertainties. What an amazing thing to me is that there is a calm and a peace seemingly before season changes. But we readily forget that in every situation, regardless, the Lord our God is with us. He is with us in the cold despair of an illness, and He is with us in the spring of our healing. He is with us in the summers of lack, and He is with us in the autumns of our prosperity. Yes. Lamentation tells us that in 3:22, through the Lord's mercies we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in Him. Well, the Amplified Bible says it this way. It is because of the Lord's mercy and loving kindness that we are not consumed, because His tender compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great and abundant is our stability and faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, or share, says my living being, my inner self. Therefore, will I hope in Him and wait expectantly for Him. Amen. Now, the Message Bible says it in more of today's language. It says, God's loyal love couldn't have run out. His merciful love couldn't have dried up. They are created new every morning. How great your faithfulness. And then it goes on to say, I'm sticking with God. I say it over and over. He's all I've got left. Are you listening to me? Well, saints of God, God's love for us is unfailing. And in all situations, not just some. He comes through
each and every time for us. There's not one season we can find ourselves in that he is not loving us with his mercy, meaning his kindness, his goodness, and his compassion. As we go into the text today, we will see how the Lord demonstrates his love and care in bits and pieces. John 6 and 5 says, "Then Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, 'Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?' But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do." Help me, Holy Ghost. Please take a note of what is happening here and how it shifts the disciples of Jesus. This crowd of people had come without having been commanded or given an invitation. They were moved to follow the Lord out of a strong desire to know and learn something from his teaching and to experience his healing power. Now, as the day went on, without anyone saying anything, Jesus recognized that the people were hungry. This certainly was a teaching moment for the disciples, but it also was a place where they were going to be involved with the responsibility of ministry. So Jesus turns to Philip asking, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" Now, Jesus had a solution to the problem, but he was in teacher mode and educating the disciples by calling their attention to the very fact that they had a responsibility and they needed a plan of action for this situation. Just a little side note, Jesus paid it all, but he didn't say he would do it all. One definition of responsibility is the state or fact of being answerable or accountable for something within one's power or control or management. Well, John 14 and 11 says, "Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly," verse 12 says, "most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." Well, when we think about it, as Jesus was preparing to depart back to heaven, he fully expected his work to go on. He did not mean for the disciples to take a layoff or a vacation. You see, his expectations seemed impossible when you think about his character, the Lord's character and power. Yet through the power of the Holy Spirit, whom Jesus sent, there were more converts after the first sermon Peter preached on the day of Pentecost than are recorded during Jesus' entire ministry while he was on earth. Jesus, during his ministry here, never traveled outside the borders of Palestine, but the young church coveted the Roman world at that time. And through the disciples, the Lord's ministry multiplied after his leaving. So Jesus expected his church to become the instrument he would manifest his salvation to all people. In other words, we are the instruments of salvation, and that is our responsibility. And why is it that we would ask Jesus to come off his throne when he has finished his work, when he says to us, "Greater works shall you do"? Are you with me so far? Well, let's go a little bit further. John 6 and verse 7, Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little." Are you listening to me? Philip had no imagination. Philip had no ideas, and he spoke in the negative. His answer to the Lord was essentially, "It can't be done." he was correct when he began to add up the money it would possibly take to feed 10,000 people. Plus, the other disciples didn't have enough money either. You see, a denarius was worth about 17 cents. It was a day's wage for an unskilled laborer or a soldier. If a man worked 6 days a week, 200 denarii would represent the pay for about 33 weeks, which would be about 8 months. Now, please understand, they didn't have time to start a savings account. Are you listening to me? One thing that hurts us more than others is listening to people who say we can't do this or that. It is really difficult to get even Christians to the point of not listening to negative people. Negative people live in their own world of negativity, and they try to press how they live on others. They spin out of control because they can't see the positive in anything. I have learned this in my life, and this is what I do. First, I pray. Secondly, I believe and trust. Thirdly, third thing I do is move by faith. Praying and sitting down does not move God, and it will cause us to become spiritual cripples. Am I talking to anybody? Well, fact of the matter, Acts 17:28 says, "For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own prophets have said, for we are also his offspring." I just got my help. No, nowhere in that scripture does it say live, but set still and don't move and have your existence in him. You have to move in faith, but you don't have to go far to find God because he lives within you. Our life and our being, every movement that we make as humans is proof that our God is near, that he is more than just near, that he is with us and around us, quickening us with his own life, upholding us by his power and sustaining us. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. I want you to take a look at John 6 and 8 again, through 9. It says, "One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, 'There is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many?'" Are you listening? Have you ever had an answer and then open your mouth and talk yourself out of it? Philip didn't have an answer to the problem, but spoke all the negative things, which didn't help to find a solution. Now here comes Andrew with the answer. But he says, "There is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish." Well, all the disciple had been, all the time that the disciples had been with Jesus, they had seen him perform miracles before over and over again. Andrew had the answer to the problem. He said, 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. Jesus knew that was the answer to the problem. If only he had stopped there. But Andrew went on to say, "But what are they among so many?" We can't feed 10,000 people with this little boy's lunch. And he was right and yet wrong at the same time. Because Andrew couldn't, but Jesus would feed them with a Thanksgiving Day fill-up meal. And then John 6 and 10 says, "Then Jesus said, 'Make the people sit down.' Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples," watch this, "and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted." Are you listening to me? Mark 6 and 14 tells us, so they sat down in ranks in hundreds and in fifties. So this thing was organized because Jesus does not do anything without a plan. He is the God, the good shepherd, who made the sheep sit down in green pastures. This made it easy to count the people and hand out the food. It had to be organized. Jesus was like Moses with the people in the wilderness who needed to be fed. I want you to notice that Jesus didn't pray and ask God. He said he thanked God. This was about to bring God the Father glory, because this thing just didn't happen. It was already purposed by the Father before the foundation of the world. So Jesus gave the food to the disciples. And as they began to pass out the food, the miracle multiplication started to take place. So the bread began to multiply. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me. The boy only had 5 body loaves, but the bread began to multiply. The fish began to multiply. Please understand, the people kept on eating and kept getting served until they were all full. That is not strange to me, because I read in Luke 1:37, for with God nothing will be impossible. Here is where I've been trying to head, and I'm going to give you some time on your money. John 6:12-13 again, he says, so when they were filled, don't miss this. When they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remains so that nothing is lost. Therefore, they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which were left over by those who had eaten. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me. Well, I want you to picture this. Now, we're not at Shoney's restaurant. We got to eat with our hands. They ain't no utensils. They just breaking bread and passing around. Y'all don't want to hear me. And when the people had enough to eat and were satisfied, Jesus told the disciples, gather up the fragments that remain so that nothing is lost. Please get this. These were not crumbs that fell on the ground. You see, fragments are broken pieces, and when the word fragment is used in the Bible, it speaks of remnants of food, or like we like to call it, leftovers. So the disciples began to go to each person who still had some leftovers in their hand. As they went around collecting, they filled 12 baskets with the leftovers. Are you listening to me? Well, I need to ask a question. How many disciples followed Jesus? The answer is 12. How many disciples served the people? The answer is also 12. How many baskets of leftovers were gathered? The answer is still 12. So what happened to those 12 baskets of food? Because Jesus says so that nothing is lost. I submit to you that the baskets went to the disciples. They had done the work serving the people, and Jesus was not going to leave them out of the miracle blessing that had been bestowed on 10,000 folk. They received the bits and pieces. But it was 12 baskets full of bits and pieces. Jesus had a plan for the bits and pieces. How do you know that, Pastor? Well, Mark 8, and starting with verse 17, says, but Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, why do you reason because you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive nor understand? Is your heart still hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? And do you not remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000? How many baskets full of fragments did you take up? They said to him, 12. Also, when I broke the 7 for the 4,000, how many large baskets full of fragments did you take up? And they said, 7. So he said to them, how is it you do not understand that if I feed other folk, you'll get the fragments? If I feed other folk, you get the fragments, but you can't get the fragments without serving somebody. All I'm trying to tell you is this. God has a plan for you and your life of service. Don't think that you are going to be left out of the blessing. He has a whole basket full of blessing just for you. The songwriter said, little becomes much when you place it in the master's hand. God deals mightily, help me, Holy Ghost, with the things that are impossible for us, but are not so impossible for God and not too hard for him. You ought to rejoice when everyone else gives up on you and disowns you, because God has a basket full of bits and pieces just for you. When the world kept saying no, you kept right on fighting the good fight of faith, and your basket of bits and pieces showed up on your doorstep. Well, I have some good news for you. That basket of bits and pieces keeps right on multiplying, because your faith keeps on growing, and you have finally realized God is not through with me yet. Every day, remind yourself that God has a plan for bits and pieces just for you. But you got to celebrate even when you're going through the storm and the rain. You got to understand that God is with you, and he's got bits and pieces. All you have to do is just trust. Bits and pieces are on the way. Don't give up and don't give out, because bits and pieces are on the way. The doctor may say one thing, but you ought to believe the report of the Lord. Bits and pieces are on the way. And in that place, you ought to give him glory, honor, and praise. Because no matter what, if God is for us, if God is for us, have I got a witness here? My children may go crazy, but I've got bits and pieces that are still on the way. I don't know what tomorrow's going to bring, but I'm waiting on my little bit and my little piece. And every time I find myself falling down, the Lord picks me up, turns me around, gives me another portion, another little bit. And I say to myself, I've got bread just for the day. Daily bread. Ain't he all right? Daily bread. Ain't God all right? In the morning, ain't he all right? Noonday, ain't he all right? In the midnight hour, ain't God? Say yeah. Say yeah. I ain't going to ever look down on little bits and pieces. Yeah. Turn up the lights. Say yeah. Yeah. I know you've been going through. 2018 might have been difficult, but God's got something waiting on you. I double dog dare you. Just get to 2019 and watch the power of God being manifested in your life. I prophesy your day is going to get better. I prophesy it's going to get better. Don't give out. Don't give in. Don't give over. God is with you. My soul says yes. My soul says yes. My soul says yes. Somebody asked me, Langford, how does it feel to get older? I said to them, when I look out, I don't see a change. It's just when I look at that I see a change. But I'm grateful for gray hairs. I'm grateful for bald head. I'm grateful for knocked and bad knees, because even then, God is able. God is able. Yeah! want you to think about that bit in peace that God showed up. It might have been Monday. It might have been Tuesday. It might have been Wednesday. But didn't God show up? And didn't he show out? Yes, he did. I wasn't expecting him to do it like he did it. But I'm showing up thankful. Yes, I am. I don't know what tomorrow's gonna bring, but I know who holds my tomorrow. And I know that he watches over me. I'm finished preaching, but I'm testifying of the goodness of God and what he's done for me. I don't know your story. I don't know where he's brought you from, but I know exactly what God has done for me, and I can testify. I was blind and could not see. Yes, I was, but early one Sunday morning, I got to the cross, and the cross got to me. And I was saved, sanctified, filled with his Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, power, wonder-working power, power, changing power, power.